Hey everyone, welcome to the January 3rd Select Board meeting. This meeting is called to order at 6:38. We are a couple members short this evening. One or two of them may show up, but they may not. We'll see. This is the first meeting of 2012. We actually have a fairly short agenda, but our first timed item isn't until 6:45, so we will fill a little time before that with untimed items. In your packets, you had, this is the first untimed item, this is an updated letter of support to DHCD for HAP tax credits for the Olympia Oaks project. This is something that when it came before us about a year ago, that we were asked to submit a letter of support for their tax credits and the various kinds of funding that they might be eligible for, and they are in a second round of that, so they asked for another letter. There's a draft letter in your packet that we thought was all set, but now the folks from HAP are just looking it over and making sure that there might be other specifics that might need to be included. Did Select Board have any comments? Ms. Stein?
I think the letter on the whole is good, but I think we could make it stronger. I would change the word support to enthusiastic, but I actually would put in a first sentence that says something along the lines of Amherst has run a homeless shelter for two winters now, and through that work have seen the increased need for affordable housing, something that's specific to us, like that as an example of our concern and the fact that we're working on it from another perspective as well, I think would be good support.
Okay. Any other comments on it? No. Okay, so I will work in a sentence like that and combine it with any additions that the folks from HAP might have as far as specifics that they know that DHCD wants to have, and we will get that out. Thank you very much for looking that over. I think, I'm not sure if we have a vote. Are we supposed to vote to support this?
So moved.
Yes.
There is a draft.
I can do it. I move that the Select Board support the application of HAP Housing for federal and state low-income housing tax credits for the Olympia Oaks Affordable Housing Project.
Is there a second?
Second.
Further discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Ms. Brewer, say aye.
Yes.
Yes. Thank you. 3 in favor, 2 absent. Thank you very much. All right, next. We've got some annual license renewals. These are just a couple of items that weren't ready for us when we dealt with them in December. So we have a sheet with a couple of renewals for common victualler and taxi licenses, and then we have a couple of in-holder licenses. Ms. Stein, would you like to make those motions?
Sure. Let's see where the renewals are.
Top of page 3.
Top of page 3. I move that the Select Board approve the applications for, is that the one? I don't think so. The ones I thought you wanted were, I don't know if that's the right one.
Is that the one that says annual licenses 2012 at the top?
I don't think so. Yes. That's why I'm looking for it.
The thing I was just going to.
There's a revised motion list on your desk, which might be your confusion.
There is? I only have this.
Nothing else?
Aha. Uh-huh.
Now it's the top of page 3.
Okay, now it's on top of page 3. All right. Not there. There. Okay. I move. That's still. These are all the annual licenses for 2012? All right.
These are the ones we still need to do tonight, yes.
Okay. I move that the Select Board approve the applications for an in-holder license for Hop Brook Bed and Breakfast, doing business as Hop Brook Enterprises at 15 Hop Brook Road, Amherst, MA.
Is there a second? Ms. Brewer, you have to be the second tonight.
Yes, I do have to be the second, and I actually wanted to ask a question. I was just double-checking. Moved over. We obviously don't have a lot of bed and breakfasts, but I think it would be helpful and not in any way damaging to list the owner's name on both of these.
Okay.
And so, as we know from our paperwork inside here.
So I think the first one is owner
Connie Krueger.
Connie Krueger.
And so we just put owner, or manager, I guess, because manager's what we put on all the other licenses. Okay. In this case, they're both so small that they're the same thing.
I so move the amended.
Okay. So have you seconded that?
Yes.
Thank you. And we've had further discussion. Any further discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Three to zero, two absent.
I move that the select board approve the applications for an in-holder license for Birdsong Bed and Breakfast at 815 Southeast Street, Amherst, MA, manager Carol Gray, I think.
Yep.
Ms. Brewer, is there a
second?
Thank you. Further discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. 3-0, 2 absent. Okay, we'll actually...
Shall we just squeeze in? I move that the select board approve renewals of taxi drivers and common victualler licenses as presented on the document entitled 2012 License Renewals Revised December 30th, 2011 for the calendar year beginning January 1, 2012 through December 31st, 2012.
Second.
Thank you. Further discussion?
And I'm just so impressed with the way everything's dated and numbered and named. It's just all so beautiful. So.
Excellent.
I'm voting.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. And that is 3-0. Okay.
If I might make one other quick comment.
Sure.
Okay. Since these are rare, it's not surprising that we made a minor thing we should do is make sure we shred these because they happen to include the social security numbers of the bed and breakfast operators.
Yep, that was brought to the office's attention. Thank you. Okay. Next up, we have a public hearing. And we have Mr. Chudzik here from Western Mass Electric. This is a pole hearing for a new pole on Sealy Street. This public hearing is being called to order at 6:45. And Mr. Chudzik, tell us about the pole. Oh, we forgot to tell you to turn on the mic. I'm sorry. As soon as I saw Candace, I knew we forgot to do that. There's a thing right on the top.
You did tell us.
Okay. Yeah. Here we go.
Thank you very much. I apologize for that.
Okay. Actually, what's happening here, this is part of the project they're going to be doing on Spring Street. And that package will be coming into your office probably tomorrow, all right? And what we have to do is we have to provide a new feed to the church and the parish house, which is off, can be fed off of Sealy Street. So we're going to be setting a pole on Sealy Street, which will be fed from Main Street. It's going to be on the westerly side of the street, of Sealy Street, southerly. If you have the sketch, you have a copy of the sketch?
Yes, we do.
Okay. And now it's currently being fed from the back off of Spring Street. So that's what we're proposing to do there.
So you're undergrounding the stuff on Spring Street is what the document
right.
says?
The new proposal that you have requested is going to be undergrounding Spring Street.
That's very exciting.
Okay. It was mentioned, just so you know, we had the option of also undergrounding, but it would have been a lot more involved to bring underground service to the church. That's why I decided to set the pole.
Okay. And according to your information, the road supervisor chose the pole location.
Right, he picked the location.
And was there any issues with trees?
No, there's no tree issues.
Okay.
No tree issues.
Okay. Any questions or comments from the select board? We have a lot of time to kill. Isn't there anything you would like to know about this?
Go ahead.
I
didn't
really get upset about this.
Okay, there's no one from the public here to comment. So then I need a motion to close the public hearing at 6:48.
I so move.
And all in favor of closing the public hearing, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. And that is 3-0. And time to deliberate. Any deliberation on the pole situation on Sealy Street? Ms. Stein, would you like to make the motion?
Sure. I move that the select board approve the request of Western Mass Electric Company and Verizon New England Incorporated to set a joint and identical location for one jointly owned pole, number 121/7T-7, on the west side of Seeley Street, approximately 51 feet southerly of Main Street, in accordance with Field Plan 6A020094.
Is there a second?
Second.
Further discussion? All in favor say aye.
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 Aye. 3-0. 2 absent. Thank you very much for coming
in.
Thank you. We appreciate the information.
Thank you.
And the underground ones.
Okay. So let's see. Our next timed item isn't until 6:55, and that person may or may not come in. So we'll see. Ms. Brewer, is there something you wanted to mention?
Did I just look like I might have mentioned something? Actually, I have a question, which is in regards to, and maybe you know the answer to this, the 7 o'clock item on support for letter of interest to Mass School Building Authority. I sort of remember doing this 2 years ago, and I thought we'd received more information at that time as to what it was. I realized that largely we're just a rubber stamp on this based on the way the process works, and it's really the school committee and the superintendent and the director of facilities, but we don't even have school committee minutes that show any discussion around this item. So when language reads the way the language does, it seems odd not to have any background information. But if I don't have it, I just want to make sure we weren't supposed to have had it, and we can obviously talk about it more when the item comes up.
So. Okay. Okay, so noted for the future. You want more information about what they're looking for.
Yes.
So I do have a little bit more information about it, but only just
helpful.
A little. So, okay, we got a couple more minutes to kill. You are here for the secondhand sales license?
Yes.
Okay, so that's our 6:55 item. We still have 5 minutes till we can deal with that. So, all right, then we've got other issues, which are we've got a couple of new taxi licenses. We might as well do those.
And new ones.
I move that the select board approve a new taxi driver slash chauffeur license for Raman Nasiri of Amherst MA on behalf of Tic Tac Taxi Company.
Second.
Second.
Brewer, thank you. We all have our roles, and Mr.
role.
Hayden is our second.
Where is Aaron when we
know
need
it.
Him?
Okay, yes. Further discussion. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. 3-0. Next.
I move that the select board approve a new taxi driver slash chauffeur license for Shane Davial of Holyoke MA, J. Krenwinkle of Northampton MA, and Stephen Parsons of Williamsburg MA on behalf of Aaron's Transportation.
Second.
Thank you for the discussion. All in favor say aye.
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 Sure, what's your question?
The medallion that goes on the top of the cabs, do we need to get the approval for those things from the town too, or that's something different? The one says that cab number or something like that. It's called medallion, right?
I don't think we do those in Amherst. We don't think we have a number.
You're referring to just the light that's on the top that talks that says taxi, or?
No, it has the number on it, too.
We don't actually have that.
I don't really know. Everything to do with regulation happens in the inspections office, and the rules all happen in the select board office, but we don't know the details at that level, I'm afraid.
The names okay. of the taxis are all there. But I have not seen the numbers.
I'm not familiar with the taxi number in Amherst. Are you familiar
with
it?
No.
Okay.
I would encourage you to call the town manager's office tomorrow, and we can find the answer to that question for you.
You're exactly
yes.
right.
Yes, Deborah, who you've been dealing with, would help you with that also. Okay, so let's see. Did we vote on that? All in favor say aye.
Yes.
Aye.
Aye. That was 3-0.
Yeah, we did both.
Okay, good.
Right.
Next taxi license. Was there another one?
We did both.
That
we did
both, right?
Okay.
And so we can do the liquor license, but other than that.
You want to do the liquor license?
Yes, please.
Shall I go?
Yes, please.
I move that the select board approve a special all-alcohol license for Greg Wardlaw, Danielle LaFerriere of Amherst College Catering for a reception to be held at the Mead Art Museum from 3 p.m. to 6 p.m. Saturday, January 21st, 2012.
Second.
Further discussion? All in favor say aye.
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 Aye. 3-0. Okay, let's see. We can probably do a couple more of these things. How about committee appointments?
Sure. I will start with the first ones that I find, which are missing.
Page 3.
Where do you see
the bottom appointments? Page 3 at the bottom just says appointments.
Okay. I move that the Select Board endorse the appointment of Ilana Schmidt to the Board of Health for a term to expire June 30th, 2014, as recommended by the town manager.
We always use the word confirm, I think, is our role, is to confirm the appointment.
Confirm.
Okay.
Second.
Further discussion?
I have a question.
Go right ahead.
Mr. Town Manager, do you know whether the current physician on the Board of Health has sent a formal letter of resignation? Because I have not seen it.
Yes, David Kaufman has officially resigned.
Okay.
And I did want to jump in and take this opportunity to thank him for his excellent service on the Board of Health. And I'm really pleased to bring forward Ilana Schmidt, pediatrician.
Wonderful.
Good ideas and energy to bring to the Board of Health. So.
Right. Thank you. I just wanted to be sure.
Yes.
So my question is fine. We can vote.
All right. So that's been moved and seconded. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. And that is 3-0.
Okay. And now I'll do the second one. I move that the Select Board confirm the appointment of Kathleen Ford to the Planning Board for a term to expire June 30th, 2014, as recommended by the town manager.
Second.
Mr. Musanti.
And I'm also happy to bring forward Kathy Ford's name to fill the current vacancy on the Planning Board, and am quite confident she'll bring her ongoing energy and commitment and common sense to the Planning Board. She's served the town over the years in many different capacities, from town meeting members to LSSC commission. She's been on the Community Preservation Act committee, doing excellent work for us. So I'm pleased to bring her name forward for the Planning Board.
Great, thank you. Further discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. 3-0. All right. Perfect timing. So it is now our 6:55 item, which is a new secondhand sales license application for Akil Ahmed of Game Central Station. Game Central Station is on North Pleasant Street. We had originally renewed the license for Mr. Yunus, Ghulam Yunus, and we'll rescind that renewal. That's one of our motions on here. And now we have the new application, which has been approved by the chief of police. So you can come forward and identify yourself, and if you can just tell us anything about the business. It's an opportunity to be a little commercial for your business. Yes, please.
I don't know about these things, so first time coming here. So
welcome. And your name?
Name is Akil Ahmed. Taking over from my father's this business, and he is not feeling comfortable that business is not good and stuff like that. So I'm like, okay, no, I'm gonna give it a try. It's not that much time period has been spent on it, so let me try it out before we just say that, okay, we cannot do it anymore. Because we have signed the lease for 3 years and plus the renewal stuff too. Like, it's too early to give up kind of thing on this one, so we're gonna give it a try. This one we do video games, movies, which are DVDs, and we allow the some gamers to come and play on our facilities too, as well as we are planning to, in order to gain more business, to take the competition or the tournament kind of thing to the colleges so that they can do the tournaments at their locations, because our store is just as small as a representation kind of thing, but not a real location that a lot of people can come and play. It's like only onesie and twosie kind of thing. Mm. But taking it to their locations and allowing them to explore and come and buy the things from us, that's what the main goal is.
Terrific. Well, good luck with that. And it looks like the economy might be starting to turn around, so you could be just
so
on
too.
The right place
and
in the right time.
With the competitors around this area, we are, I mean, this first of a kind, we are not not really like trying to compete with them, but still, our prices are much better than their prices because they are more corporate driven and we are not. So we have a control on the pricing. They even though they get a lot of copies from, you know, from the corporate that they can have it available, even though we get very few, but we have more control on the pricing ourselves. So whatever we can, we give it to the students from trading point of view or buying from the new games point of view too.
Great.
Well, that includes, of course, the consoles that you use to play the games.
We wish you good luck. And the reason this comes before the select board, most business licenses don't. There are certain categories of licenses right. that do, and it's the secondhand sales part of this license that does. So a small part of your inventory is secondhand. Most of your stuff is new. Is that correct?
It's mixed.
So this,
because if we get a lot of new ones, new ones really do not get you a lot of profit. That's the business model. A lot of these old stores or the big name stores, they are going into the same model too, that they buy back from the customers. And buying back is, there's a percentage that you can give them back, but not 100% kind of thing, because it's already pre-owned stuff.
Sure.
So it gives you a little bit more of a profit margin.
Sure. And just historically, secondhand licenses are something that gets checked by the chief of police to make sure that it's not stolen mm-hmm. goods that are being sold or whatever. So that's why this license comes before us, is in one of the categories that comes before us. You wouldn't even need to be here if all of your stuff was new. It's just an interesting technicality of that part.
We do take the IDs of the individuals who try to bring in their stuff that they want to resell, so that we make sure that, okay, this is your product. It doesn't say on the product or name of the person or anything, but at least the person that who is bringing it, the product, at least we know that who brought it in.
And you're familiar with the police chief has certain record keeping requirements that you need to do with secondhand.
We have
sales,
not been told any of the record keeping point of view, but we are trying to keep as much we can. Because the systems, we are not, as I said, we are not like big corporate that we can take a picture and picture will be attached to the transaction kind of thing. That's like a lot of money. but we do take the IDs or the information from the customer so that we can add it to the transaction kind of thing, but as a separate piece. It doesn't go into the same system.
Okay.
But we try as much possible to not allow someone who is not the owner of the product, and also not allowing the youngs or like, which if you're not allowed to play the mature games, like teenager games, and you're only like 10 or 12, we will not sell it. Even though we are trying to, you know, kill our business, but we do not, because we have our own kids and cousins and nephews. We don't want them to get the game from somewhere if they're not allowed to play those games too.
Good. Okay. Ms. Brewer, you have a question?
And this is not for the applicant. This is more of our
sure.
internal thing. Just like you saw, we had questions yeah. about how the technicalities of taxi things work, because luckily we don't have to know that. Is that since we had the follow-up from the police chief, since, again, we don't do a lot of secondhand licenses as new ones. It's just like same old, with the same people. He had asked about the record keeping and you know, our usual response is to say, let's make sure that when the license gets issued, it says on it somewhere what the requirements are. But the office pointed out that the license form itself does say on the license form what needs to be kept, but as is perhaps not surprising, given some of my other pet peeves for other items on tonight's agenda, it says on the actual license, I recommend, it doesn't say who I is, but I recommend that the licensee be required to maintain written records, blah, blah, blah. What? That's like, that doesn't even make sense. So it's probably some vestige of, you know, what Mass Law said, but it doesn't even say that the police chief's recommending that, the select board's recommending that, and I think it's required, because that is what everybody does. So maybe we can ask them to maybe see if there's a little whiteout sort of thing that can work on that, that the language is left over from 1879 or something. And because it otherwise, I mean, if it said recommend to me, I might think, well, that's a nice idea, but
optional.
Am I required? Yeah.
Right. Okay. We can have the office look into that updating the form going forward.
The right place to track that down.
Any other questions or comments? Ms. Stein, would you like to make the motion?
Sure. There are two. I move that the Select Board rescind the 2012 secondhand license approved Monday, December 5th, 2011, as part of the list of renewals for alcohol and non-alcohol licenses presented that evening, dated December 2nd, 2011.
Second.
Further discussion? All in favor, say aye.
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 I move that the Select Board approve the application for a license to operate secondhand sales to Game Central Station, Incorporated, at 220 North Pleasant Street, Amherst, MA 01002, Akhil Ahmed, owner.
Second.
Further discussion? All in favor, say aye.
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 3-0, you're approved. Okay. Thank you very much coming in. Congratulations and good luck with your business.
Good luck.
Ms. Stein.
We did committee appointments, but I noted that we have two more in our packet that I don't think are on the motion sheet, and I wondered how we were going to deal with that. One was for a recycling committee.
The town manager has the answer to that, and you'll remember it as soon as he says it.
Maybe I will and maybe I won't.
They're his appointments.
In my town manager report, I was going to mention two appointments I've made, one to the LSSC Commission, John Foster, and Sue Cairn, Recycling Refuse Management Committee.
We don't have
as an information item, not requiring Select Board action.
Okay. That's what you get for telling us information. Makes us want to do something.
Yeah, I just felt like, you know, I should do this.
Let's vote.
Sorry, I have two less motions to make. I don't know if I can stand
this. You're shortening my report.
Thank you.
Okay, 7:05, where are we? 7 o'clock item, consider and vote positions on support letter of interest in Mass School Building Authority. All right, Mr. Bohanowitz is not going to be joining us this evening. Ms. Brewer already alluded to this item. This is something that the Select Board has to do, as she mentioned, as a technicality when the schools apply for new capital funding. Ms. Kruger has kindly joined us. You don't actually have to be here for that license. Oh, okay. So we already approved your license. So,
it was hard to figure out the timing on the time.
Okay. So we'll get to you in a moment. Okay. So this is something that the Select Board has to do when the schools are putting forth an application for potential funding for those various priority categories. Just to stay in the queue, essentially, with the Mass School Building Authority. I had asked Mr. Bohanowitz, how come we haven't done this since 2009? It's been a while. It was something that used to happen kind of in the fall every year, but now we haven't done it in a while. And the answer was because there was actually kind of a gap in the requests, and you only have to redo the vote when you have a change to your request. So, in 2010, he called it 2010, I don't know if he means the 2011 funding year, but the concentration was on the middle school windows, and apparently because that was a regional thing, that didn't require the Select Board vote.
Right.
So now there's been a gap in the requests, the annual requests. So now that we have a new request, which also doesn't include the middle school, which is different from the past, the middle school, what am I saying? Mark's Meadow, which is different from the past requests. Now we are making this request on behalf of, or the schools rather, are making this request on behalf of potential grants that could come from MSBA for Fort River School and for Wildwood School. That's almost everything I know. But if you have more questions, try me.
So, for those of you who just love this sort of information, again, this is really the school committee's purview, and it's the technicality that the Select Board or the town council has to deal with this, city council has to deal with this, just because that's the way Massachusetts is. It doesn't, as it will say in our motion, it doesn't tie our hands, it doesn't commit us to anything, it simply gets ourselves back in the queue, which is something they just require that we do every so often. The comments, the other comments I wanted to make were, one, the school building authority has done a pretty good job lately of putting up the long form application. So if you wanted to know what it said and all that stuff from 2009 for the 2010 money, that's all online. So you can look at those details as to what they had to fill out. I'm sure the school committee would have seen those. In future, if we could mention to Mr. Bohanowitz that we should have a copy, I think, of the minutes from the school committee showing that they did this, because I wouldn't want to feel like we're doing it before them with, you know, we have wonderful communication and no fighting between us, but in another land at another time, it might be awkward if somehow, for some reason, we had to vote before them and we weren't realizing we were doing it.
Okay.
Although sometimes for deadlines, one has to do things out of order. The other comment I just wanted to make is for those who, for whatever reason, might hear the motion, see the information in our packet, it talks about the priority, and these are the categories that the state sets up. This is not wording that we came up with. It's simply forms on the infamous checklist that Alyssa sort of likes to use, and it checks off most of the items. If I were a parent and I didn't send my children to those schools and I thought that the English language meant what the words said, I would be nervous that my children were going to a school that was structurally unsound or seriously jeopardizing the health and safety of school children, or where existing severe overcrowding, which is completely different than 2 years ago, and strangely, we closed a school in the intervening time as well, I would be very, very concerned. It's my understanding from having served on the school committee in the past that while we feel very uncomfortable with some of the aspects of the schools, the roof is not going to cave in. No one's unsafe from the standpoint of going to school every day. They're not going to fall into a hole that hasn't been repaired. The overcrowding is not so severe that kids can't fit into the classrooms. So please just understand that when you read these are priorities that the state's established and that we are trying to make a case, we being the school committee and the school personnel are trying to make a case that we do have some serious needs that need to be addressed, largely associated with the quads no longer being used the way somebody thought they needed to be used a long time ago versus the reality of education in 2011, 2012. So don't take this as meaning something it doesn't. And if you have concerns, obviously ask the school. I personally am not at all happy about having to even vote that these things are true, because I disagree that they're true. But on the other hand, I want the application to get in line along with everybody else. I know there are still schools in the state of Massachusetts that are in much worse structural shape than ours, and we're not going to be coming to the top of the list anytime soon. It's also true that the Mass School Building Association is going to come out and look at things before they give us money. It's not like we're telling them one thing and then they'll be surprised when it looks like something else. There are all kinds of details that get worked out in the meantime. So that's a long way of saying it doesn't matter what it actually says, and I'll go ahead and vote for it.
Mr. Musanti?
I want to second everything Ms. Brewer just said. And from our collective experience in my former role as finance director, current role, your various roles, this allows us to be on a potential funding list for a potential future grant that could be upwards of 60% of renovation costs at one or both of the elementary schools. And it's important for us to be in that queue. And the vote is being updated because since our last time submitting for the Amherst Public Schools, our Marks Meadow has closed. So Marks Meadow was part of the previous application from when you voted last time. So there are needs in the physical plant for both Wildwood and Fort River as they're over 40 years of service so far. Having said that, the town, through its capital budget and working closely with the school administration, has not ignored those buildings. There has been substantial investment. Wildwood roof, Wildwood entranceway, some interior work at Wildwood over the summer, energy system improvements at Fort River School. The regional schools, again, the biggest project is the replacement of 400 windows at the middle school with 60% state grant funding through an energy efficiency program. So we're not at the top of the list, and we're not close to the top of the list, and that's a sad statement on the state of school conditions across Massachusetts, and across the country for that matter, but it's important for us to be in the queue for consideration, because we know those buildings do need work, and we need some broad-based tax revenue from the state budget to help Amherst make those improvements over the coming decade to Fort River and Wildwood. So it's important that we're on record for this, and we will get you the minutes of the school committee when they're available.
Thank you. And just so you know, the school committee has taken this vote. So while I don't know what their discussion was, I do know that we are officially taking our vote after they have taken their vote. And unfortunately, we have to read all that great bunch of information into the minutes. So
I'm up to the task.
I like this so much, Ms. Stein.
Would you rather?
No, go ahead.
I move that the select board authorize the superintendent to submit to the Massachusetts School Building Authority the Statement of Interest form dated January 9, 2012, for the Wildwood Elementary School located at 71 Strong Street, Amherst, MA, which describes and explains the following deficiencies and the priority categories for which an application may be submitted to the Massachusetts School Building Authority in the future. Priority 1, replacement or renovation of a building which is structurally unsound or otherwise in a condition seriously jeopardizing the health and safety of school children where no alternative exists. Priority 2, elimination of existing severe overcrowding. Priority 4, prevention of severe overcrowding expecting to result from increased enrollments. Priority 5, replacement, renovation, or modernization of school facility systems such as roofs, windows, boilers, heating, and ventilation systems to increase energy conservation and decrease energy-related costs in a school facility. Priority 6, short-term enrollment growth. Priority 7, replacement of or addition to obsolete buildings in order to provide for a full range of programs consistent with state and approved local requirements. And hereby further specifically acknowledges that by submitting this statement of interest form, the Massachusetts School Building Authority in no way guarantees the acceptance or the approval of an application, the awarding of a grant, or any other funding commitment from the Massachusetts School Building Authority, or commits the city/town/regional school district to filing an application for funding with the Massachusetts School Building Authority. I guess we vote that one, and then I read the next one.
Yes. Ms. Brewer, would you like to second
that? I'd like to second that.
Thank you. Further discussion? All in favor, say aye.
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 Mm-hmm. Next.
I move that the select board authorize the superintendent to submit to the Massachusetts School Building Authority the Statement of Interest form dated January 9, 2012, for the Fort River Elementary School located at 70 Southeast Street, Amherst, MA, which describes and explains the following deficiencies and the priority categories for which an application may be submitted to the Massachusetts School Building Authority in the future. Priority 1, replacement or renovation of a building which is structurally unsound or otherwise in a condition seriously jeopardizing the health and safety of school children where no alternative exists. Priority 2, elimination of existing severe overcrowding. Priority 4, prevention of severe overcrowding expected to result from increased enrollments. Priority 5, replacement, renovation, or modernization of school facility systems such as roofs, windows, boilers, heating, and ventilation systems to increase energy conservation and decrease energy-related costs in a school facility. Priority 6, short-term enrollment growth. Priority 7, replacement of or addition to obsolete buildings in order to provide for a full range of programs consistent with state and approved local requirements, and hereby further specifically acknowledges that by submitting the Statement of Interest form, the Massachusetts School Building Authority in no way guarantees the acceptance or the approval of an application, the awarding of a grant, or any other funding commitment from the Massachusetts School Building Authority, or commits the city/town/regional school district to filing an application for funding with the Massachusetts School Building Authority.
Ms. Brewer.
Second.
Thank you. Further discussion? All in favor, say aye.
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 Aye. 3-0. Thank you. All right. That part is done. So before we move on to the next one, let's deal with Ms. Kruger. So if you come forward. Just so you know, I apologize for the miscommunication. Untimed items are by definition untimed, and we don't expect anybody to come in for them. If we were expecting somebody to come in, we would have timed it.
I knew that, didn't know if I came back from an appointment in Boston and didn't know if I'd come or not, and then I thought, oh, I can do this. Thank you for granting Hopbrook Bed and Breakfast the inholders and common victualler's license. But the reason I wanted to come in and talk to you is I started this business sometime between I started working on it last January, and I opened in March. And I had a really hard time figuring out the rules, permits, and licenses required. So I was quite surprised when I got a call from Select Board Board's office informing me that I needed this additional license. So I just want, if you could indulge me for a minute, explain what the process was, because I have a suggestion to make. And I have no problem with the license request or fee. I'm all for regulation. I love it, truly. So when I started, I looked in the zoning bylaw, because I had this concept of a bed and breakfast in a part of my house. And it turns out that up to 3 guests are a by right use in my zoning district, and I don't have room for more than 3 guests, so it was an allowed by right use. That was fine. I talked to people in the planning department to confirm that. I went to the clerk, and I got a doing business as for my business. That was a $70 fee. And then I somewhere along the line knew, because I was going to be serving breakfast, that I needed to deal with the health department. So I contacted the health department, and in fact, yes, there's an inspection and a license fee. It's $175 a year for that license. And Javier Mir came out and did the inspection. It was great. And she said, and by the way, you need to take a ServSafe class, and I'll give you information about how to do that, and you need to get your ServSafe license. It's the same license that's required for people who manage hospital kitchens, hot dog stands, everything. So I took a course at Greenfield Community College and paid the $225, took the test, and got my ServSafe license. I also, along the way, as part of that, had to take an allergen awareness certification online test, so I did that. When Javier came out, she said, you need to get in touch with the building commissioner. And I said, well, my information is it's a by right use. Why would I contact the building commissioner? And she said, well, you just have to. That's how we do it. So I contacted Ms. Weeks in the inspection services department. And she said, yes, you're a by right use, but I really recommend you file a parking plan. That way, if somebody calls or a neighbor has a question, I can say you've complied with all the requirements and you have this plan on file. So I drew one up from an aerial photo and submitted it. That was fine. It was not required, but probably a really good idea. I checked for the requirements for a sign for my business, and I met the zoning bylaw requirements for that, so I didn't need a permit, but I put up the sign. And so I really wanted to do it by the book, and there were a lot of steps. But my point is, none of this is in one place. And even the experts that I talked to and asked questions of did not know what all the requirements were for a bed and breakfast in the town of Amherst. Ms. Murr said, we would like to do an information handout on this, but we really haven't had time. When the woman called from the Select Board office, she said, we'd really like to do a handbook on this or a guide. I don't know when we'll do it. So I would like to recommend that the town, maybe with the Chamber of Commerce, get together and put out a very brief permit information license guideline piece for bed and breakfast, so that other people who want to do this will be able to find in one place all of this information. And for some people, they're going to need a special permit. They're going to need, you know, there's other parts that I didn't have to do, but it can get even more complicated. And I just did a, I don't know that I have quite all of it, but I've already, this represents about $530 in fees, applications, et cetera. So it's not a small thing. And if the town was interested, I'd be happy to volunteer to help in putting this piece together, because I think it's a really nice complement to our small businesses in town. But I just have to say, it was really a puzzle to try to figure out what was required. So I was a little shocked when I found out I didn't have a necessary license.
Okay. Thank you very much. We appreciate the information and the suggestions for how to improve it going
Thanks.
Forward. It's nice to have that, something that's not just a complaint, but a suggestion. So.
Right. So thanks for listening.
Okay. Appreciate you coming in, and I apologize for the confusion about what, needing to come in or not.
That's No. I knew that part, but
okay.
I took my chances.
Okay. Terrific. Thank you very much.
Annie.
Okay. Next up, we've got the Mexico Cities Pact. Ms. Stein, tell us a little bit about this.
Okay. This is about a request to enter Amherst as a global city in a covenant on climate. And for some reason, it came addressed to me, I'm not quite sure why, from a group that's long established in this field called ICLEI. I called Stephanie Ciccarello, who's our sustainability coordinator, to discuss it with her. And her feeling was very strong that we should not join this at this time, that our energy should be focused on becoming a green community, which will have a more important impact in terms of energy conservation for the town, and that this would take away from that effort. There are a couple of other points she made about it, that most of the cities that have signed on right now are not from the U.S. anyway. And secondly, that belonging to ICLEI has a cost to the town, financial cost. I don't know what it is, because it was not part of the information they sent us, which you all have in your packets. But it seemed to me that since Stephanie Ciccarello is in charge of our sustainability efforts, her argument in terms of working on the green community seemed dead on, and I'm willing to vote no on this.
Okay. So Ms. Stein had given this information to me a few weeks ago, and it seemed ready to go at that point. And in the meantime, it turns out that it's not. So I think we don't need to take any action on it at all, unless Ms. Brewer would prefer to take some action on it. We would have otherwise made an affirmative vote, but I don't think we necessarily need to make a vote that to not do anything. Ms. Brewer.
And I would ask, I would defer the exact wording of it to something that we might ever be able to find again, given that it's got a number of different names. But I wonder if we might just put a line in the minutes associated with it that says, Ms. Stein, you know, spoke with Mr. Corello, and the select board agreed that the information regarding the Global Cities Covenant on Climate, Mexico City Pact, while interesting, is not our primary focus and is not something we intend to take a position on. Just
at
something
this
like
time.
That. Yeah, at this time.
Because
of the green. So basically what you just said as a sentence in our minutes, and then that way we like dealt with it. If anybody ever says, well, what'd you ever do about that? How come you haven't done this marvelous thing? But it's not something we're continuing to work on right now.
Okay. Anybody want to do anything other than that? Very good. Okay.
I just wondered if Mr. Musanti wanted to add anything, because I know that you also have had a conversation.
I just want to
Ms.
confirm. I've also had updated communication from Stephanie Ciccarello, our sustainability coordinator, since we posted this to the agenda. And it's basically, it's we're not ready yet in the queue of things that we're working on in that area, focusing on the Green Communities Act application this spring. There's a 5-year energy conservation plan that's a requirement of that. And when we're done with that effort, we're in a better position to devote the person hours we need to look at things like CO2 emissions and documenting those, et cetera, et cetera. And Stephanie has some thoughts on the best way to do that and who we might partner with to do it more accurately and efficiently. So I think it's one of these we're very interested in pursuing this, but not just yet.
Thank you. Okay. Then the next item is Mass Municipal Association resolutions for annual meeting. This is something that we do every year. This is a vote to authorize the chair to vote on behalf of our town for these resolutions or against them, as we see fit, that the Mass Municipal Association Policy Committee has been working on and put together for recommendation to all the cities and towns for the annual meeting that is coming up on January 21st. There are three resolutions this time. These are a little bit more general, I was noticing, than they have been in recent years. They're less kind of specifically petitioning the governor to do a certain thing or the legislature to do a certain thing. They're a little bit bigger in scope and involving the federal government. So the first one is about the transportation finance crisis, and it's basically saying that between the federal government and our local state government, they can't keep cutting funds to our infrastructure and roads and bridges. And it is essentially encouraging adequate investment in that area. The second one is a resolution opposing unfunded mandates on cities and towns. And this is sort of unfunded mandates in general, but also about water quality. There's a lot of consideration being given to, I don't know that much about this, so I can't speak about that intelligently, but it has to do with potential ballot initiative. Do you know anything about the ballot initiative? This is sort of obliquely a reaction to the ballot initiative.
An effort that's been talked about in different referendum writing circles that are out there in the state to have a ballot referendum mandating even stricter water quality standards. And so the concern is that however well-intentioned some or all of those proposals might be, when they come with no corresponding assistance to help communities and their ratepayers fund those improvements, then that becomes what we call an unfunded mandate. And so there needs to be two parts of the conversation. One is what's needed, but two, what's the most equitable way to pay for these improvements? And that's where this resolution comes into play.
And do you know more about the specifics of the initiative that is being considered?
I don't know a lot about that particular one.
Okay. Ms. Brewer, comments?
I was just going to mention that maybe what you're asking is the thing that somebody's mentioned at least one meeting I've been at, where there are people, and it came up here before too, because there are actually people out there, strange though it may seem to us, that want to apply the limits of 2.5.
That's right.
To water and sewer rates. Mm-hmm. Which, you know, sounds really good to the taxpayer on the surface of it, and then they realize, oh wait, that would be a horrible disaster. So they want to limit those changes in the same way that operating budgets are limited, and it's under the guise of taxpayer relief. And that, I don't know that that's gone anywhere this year, but I know there was something filed at some point, but just like there are lots of things filed, right, but then don't make it all the way up the ladder, there's been noise about such a thing. And so I think it was very appropriate that they went ahead and said, oh, by the way, that includes us doing it to ourselves kind of thing. You know, it's one thing to have an unfunded mandate, but then we're artificially tying our own hands by agreeing to a Proposition 2.5 limitation.
Right. Thank you. So that is the that is exactly what I was thinking of. And so I'm reading this and thinking, you know, all right, here they've created this in sort of a reaction to that, but I couldn't remember the specifics of what that was. And because strangely, they didn't really include it too directly.
Right. They didn't say it really flat out.
Exactly. Yeah. So all right. So that's what that one is about. And then the third one is again kind of very general, talking about federal it's calling on, calling on the U.S. government to embrace a strong fiscal and economic partnership with cities and towns. And this is really getting to an issue that we've talked about a couple times regarding our expectations for the budget going forward, which is to say that if the federal government cuts significant programs that are funded at the state level and locally, then the state would need to fill in those gaps. So this is about really looking at kind of the complete picture, whether it has to do with grant funding and infrastructure funding, all kinds of social service funding, that there needs to be a real conversation going on with the states and with the localities, with the municipalities, local municipalities. And MMA is proposing to have a big role in a statewide conversation and how that continues with the federal government. Anything else to say?
And I would just add, I mean, this, so it's about a big picture concept, but it's also a very real issue front and center. In the upcoming session, well, in the second half of the current session of Congress, about what's the appropriate role of the federal government going forward as it grapples with its own budget deficit issues, and urging our partners in the federal government to continue to play a vital role in serving poor people through community development block grant funding that primarily serves low and moderate income individuals and families, our Title I program serving some of our neediest students in our public schools, infrastructure, a whole wide range of things, serving people in our community, veteran services, et cetera. So it's an important resolution and one that will have real debate both in Congress and in the presidential election in the year ahead.
So it's kind of like don't be solving your problems at the federal level by trying to balance your budget on the backs of all of us at the state and local levels. You know, I was saying these are more general than they have been in the past. In the past, they've been calling for things like
Local option taxes,
exactly. Yeah. The ability for the governor to sign into law and the legislature to approve something that municipalities want. And this is
that is one element of these. They mentioned don't put any restraints on us in terms of raising local funding.
Right. So it's just a little bit different than usual, though. Interesting.
Yes.
Ms. Brewer.
I was just going to add that, again, we always fuss about what we're calling this, endorsing or, you know, allowing or authorizing or whatever, because, again, ironically, of course, the three of us are the ones going to the MMA meeting. But in a case where not everyone was going and people, say, on a previous select board I served on, people didn't really know what was going to be happening at the meeting, et cetera. It's important that when something is relatively specific, as these are not, that if something gets changed drastically on the floor, that we're still saying, we trust that you'll figure out what to do based on all the conversations we've had in the past. And, you know, not that Amherst vote is likely to make a big difference to somebody, but occasionally with, you know, some things like local options, there have been really some heated debates between different parts of the state as to how that plays out for them and the fact that it doesn't protect them enough or offer enough to them in comparison to other things. These are all so broad that it's kind of hard to imagine them not just going sailing right through and moving on to something else.
It's funny that you mentioned that, because that was specifically in my notes from last year that are on my calendar for this item for this year, is to explicitly ask for the ability to use my best judgment on amendments that are made from the floor. Because, I mean, technically the vote here is authorizing support of these, but, you know, they do get tweaked a little bit on the floor. So it's a sense of, okay, is this still in the spirit of what we were approving? So I was gonna specifically ask for that. Ms. Stein.
Can we change the word endorsed in the motion to vote for?
Sure.
Because that's actually what you do, right?
All right, so let's get to the motion sheet. Let's see, where are we?
It's on the second page. Second up from the bottom.
Okay, yes.
While we're altering it.
You want to put in or amended? the three proposed resolutions.
I think we wanted to say to authorize the chair to vote for.
Yeah, to authorize the chair to vote for, because that's who normally gets the vote. But, you know, to make it clear that we knew this was going to happen. And I don't know if we want to, if we need to bother saying anything about the sense of using your best judgment, although obviously you're welcome to word that in there. And the other thing I was just going to say is it's the January 21, 2012 meeting. For everybody who's going to be reading this next year and wondering which year we were talking about these fascinating resolutions.
Right. I think that's a good point.
Okay,
January 21st.
Yeah. That's the way that's what they date it on the resolution.
Okay. So to vote to authorize the chair to vote for the three proposed resolutions to be considered, blah, blah, blah. And I think it can just be an understanding about using your judgment on amendments, if that's okay with you all.
And where are you going to put the date in the title?
After meeting.
Put it someplace.
After association business meeting, January 21st, 2012, on transportation finance.
Okay.
All right. Would you like to make the motion?
I would. I move at the... that the select board authorize the chair to vote for the three proposed resolutions to be considered at the annual Massachusetts Municipal Association business meeting on the transportation finance crisis, opposing unfunded mandates on cities and towns of the Commonwealth, and calling on the U.S. government to embrace a strong fiscal and economic partnership with cities and towns.
Somewhere in there it says January 1, 2012.
With a date
added. That's wonderful. Okay. And Alyssa's happy to second that.
Further discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. 3-0. Okay. Next up, FY 13 budget update. Mr. Musanti, so this is our last meeting before we meet on Friday the 13th. For a budget presentation meeting. So this is, we had a preview of the budget at our last meeting in December, and now if there's any sort of further update to give us about that, that is going to start, actually, I apologize, with the announcement of the FY13 water and sewer rates, which we have a memo in our packet about. The memo suggests a motion on approving this, but we're actually going to approve this at our last January meeting, so that folks, we're just kind of announcing the rates, getting them out there, so people are aware of them. If they have any concerns about them, they can express them between now and our final meeting, which is the 23rd, thank you, of January. So why don't you tell us first about the water and sewer rates?
Sure, and this is really a preview of a vote we are recommending you take at your next meeting. The budgets that I will be recommending for the fiscal year beginning July 1st include some what I think are modest increases in both the water and sewer enterprise fund budgets that fund the water treatment and distribution system in the town, and also the sewer collection and treatment system. Those budgets, since really the 1980s, when the town went to this model of using enterprise funds, we recover the full cost of both operating and capital costs to operate and maintain the water and sewer systems from ratepayers. And so ratepayers pay a rate per 100 cubic feet of use. So the more water you use, the more you pay for water and sewer. And we are recommending to support the recommended budgets increases to the water and sewer rate of approximately 3% each, be an increase in each rate of 10 cents per 100 cubic feet. Water would go from $3.30 to $3.40 per 100 cubic feet. Sewer would go from $3.35 to $3.45 per 100 cubic feet. That will cost the average four-person household roughly an additional $12 per year, dollar per month, increase for water and a comparable increase for sewer. That will bring our average water bill for a four-person household to $408 per year, and the average sewer bill to about $414 per year. I've cited in my memo to the board that's in your packet, that even with those increases, our rates remain substantially below many other communities' water and sewer rates in our region, and substantially below the average water and sewer rate across the Commonwealth. We rely on a survey that the engineering firm Tye & Bond conducts each year that suggested that even 2 years ago now, which is the most current statewide data, the average water bill statewide was $470. And even with this 2012 increase that we're looking at for the town, ours is at $408 for water. And this average sewer bill statewide is $638. And even with our increase, our sewer bill on average would go to $414. So we still feel good about the competitiveness of both of those rates, and we feel good about the budgets and operations that that supports, because we continue our long-standing effort to adequately fund preventive maintenance and capital improvements, both at our treatment plant as well as the collection and distribution systems. And that will, there's funding in both of those areas that you will see in the recommended budgets for next year. I do want to mention for the record, we had a unanimous vote from town meeting back in November to approve the select board and my recommendation to fund sewer extensions to the Wildflower Drive area in Amherst Woods, as well as Harkness Road, which were recommended on the sewer extension master plan that the board supported this fall. Those capital outlays, which will be reflected in debt service over the next couple of years, will have a nominal effect on rates, because on the sewer side, because at the same time we're implementing those sewer extensions in those two neighborhoods, we're retiring old debt for the Chapel Middle Street sewer extensions that were funded about 9 years ago now. So the old debt service is being replaced in the budget with the new debt service. So that these rate increases really are not related to that effort.
And there was no increase in water rate last year.
That's correct.
A sewer rate increase of 10 cents last year. Is that right?
Yes.
So it's been 2 years since our water rate has increased.
Right, exactly.
Okay. Questions or comments about this from Mr. Musietti? Ms. Brewer.
Well, first of all, Ms. Brewer, I wanted to really thank the fact that the memo includes reference to not just Harkness Road and Wildflower Drive, but also the sewer extension master plan, to make it really clear to people that this is a plan that we're
right.
following, and those are the two particular areas that are happening at this particular time. I just think that's a really useful reference. The other thing, and you know, I was really worried this is going to sound like I'm going to say, I'm just curious, because I hate those words. And I'm not just curious. I think it's really weird, but I'll bet there's a really easy explanation for this that probably no one here has off the top of their heads. But does it strike anyone else as odd that between our water and sewer, there's only a $6 difference in our rates, but there are much bigger differences in a lot of other areas, like, you know, $36, $97, $168. I just wondered, you know, why are we so much smarter than everybody else, that like our bills are so much closer, whereas particularly when you mention, you know, the statewide average, the sewer bill is just astronomical. So how does that work?
I think from the statewide perspective, you know, many of the communities that we compare ourselves to are in the greater Boston area.
Mm-hmm.
So the greater Boston Mass Water Resources Authority district, they're paying the local share of Boston Harbor cleanup, which is it's both water and sewer, but the bigger impact on that cleanup is on the sewer side, both with sewage treatment and dealing with what's called combined sewer overflows, where when you have a heavy rain, the sewer system has infiltration and it doesn't have enough capacity, and so there's overflow that occurs into the rivers and harbor. So there's a multi-billion dollar program well in place to deal with that. And so There's a lot of federal financial support for that effort, but there's also a very significant local share. So the average sewer bill in some of those greater Boston communities is at or above $1,000 a year for the four-person household.
Thank you. That's really helpful.
Ms. Stein.
I was wondering if it's comparable to, from one town to the next, the percent of homes that are on sewers.
I'm not aware that that data
exists.
It may exist, but I haven't seen it.
Okay.
I know that we're roughly 93% sewer, just thinking back to the factoids related to the sewer extension.
Yeah, but I mean, that's useful.
Work, which is a relatively high percentage, particularly for a more rural community like ours in Massachusetts.
You might think that would make our bill higher. That's why I was asking.
Yeah.
So that's good to know.
Okay, so that's just a preview. That's so folks, especially the public, knows that that is that the budget, the water and sewer budgets, are based on those rates, and the select board needs to approve those rates prior to the budget going forward, and we will do that at the end of January. So if folks have comments,
I would just add that these are rates that we're recommending be effective for July 1st. So another advantage that we've done the last couple of years is try to take action on these rates right around this time, so that there's 5 or 6 months notice to customers that there's an increase pending on their next quarterly bill that they would receive beginning this summer.
Exactly. Thank you. That's an important point, because in the past, once the new bills came out, people were saying, wait a minute, when did this happen? And it was realized through some, you know, there were some complicated discussions back then, that these rates are baked into the budget proposal for the new year, so they might as well be brought front and center at that time and called out and announced, so that people recognize, as Mr. Musanti said, the notice, the few months' notice, that the their rates are going to go up a little bit at that time. So, Ms. Brewer.
Which asks me to just belabor that for a moment, which is that although we know that, and of course all our reading public and listening public knows that, will that actually go in the next set of bills that goes out? You know, the select board voted on January 23rd, 2012 to make a rate increase in July. I'm not sure we've normally done that, but that would be even better notice if we were able to do that. And there's kind of a rolling schedule.
Yeah, we'll look into that. We have the capability on our software to insert messages.
Right.
So I will follow up on that.
That formal notice might be even better. Use it while you can.
Okay. Stockpile your water at the cheaper rate. Okay, moving right along. So the FY13 budget update. So anything else for us to know in advance of the January 13th presentation?
I don't have any real new information, although we're very much looking forward, obviously, to Governor Patrick's presentation to the Mass Municipal Conference on the 20th, you know, several hours after I submit my recommended budget. So we're looking forward to that, and Mr. Pooler and I are completing the budget proposal and summary information primarily. That will be the basis for the presentation on the 13th, and hopefully you'll get your beautifully bound budget book that day there. That's what we're expecting to be able to do. So I don't have anything really new for you tonight.
So this is really just on there to, as a placeholder, in case there was any new information, any dramatic new expectations or whatever on your end, or questions from the select board prior to the January 13th presentation. So are there any questions from select board? No. Okay, then next up we have the town manager's report.
Right, and I have a few items, and let me punch through these relatively quickly. First item, building commissioner recruitment. We are in the midst of a recruitment process to hire a new building commissioner to replace Bonnie Weeks, who served her last day in town service last Friday, December 30th. And I want to thank Bonnie again for her service to the community. We have received a number of applications for that position that we've been advertising. A screening panel has been named by me to screen applicants and bring to me during the month of January one or more candidates for my consideration. I will then meet with those individuals and make a decision about who and whether to make an offer to. And my goal on all of this is to have these interviews occur during the month of January and make a job offer by the end of January, with the start date to be determined by the circumstances of the successful candidate. But we're very excited about this. It's a very, very important position in terms of keeping the town safe and life safety and building code issues, serving as our zoning enforcement officer as well, and really looking for an ideal candidate that is very responsive to those needs, being able to both enforce the building code appropriately, but also be able to work constructively with applicants, current and prospective people wanting to invest time and money in the town of Amherst. So it's an important position, and it's a high priority for me in the month ahead as we work to name a new permanent building commissioner. Related to that, I did appoint Dave Waskevich, who's been a building inspector for us for a number of years. He is now serving as acting building commissioner effective January 1st, and will be in that capacity until a permanent commissioner is appointed. I'm quite confident Dave will be able to handle things in the interim while we complete this process.
Thank you. Questions or comments about that? Ms. Brewer.
I just want to thank the town manager for including the advertisement and the position description. I think that's really useful information, and I'm not going to keep it because I know it's online, but I think it's really valuable when we do these major hires like that to have a good sense of what those positions are, so thank you.
All right. Next, I just wanted to, for public consumption, briefly talk about the fact that we've reached a contract settlement with our last of four bargaining units that I negotiate employment agreements with, and that's our AFSCME DPW unit, which is comprised of most of the members of the Department of Public Works, water, sewer, solid waste, streets, cemeteries, parks and grounds, do a lot of work for us, and I'm pleased with the terms. It's a two-year agreement that goes through June 30th, 2013. There are two key provisions in it. One is the wage provision. The contract calls for a 2% adjustment January 1, 2012, and then another 2% adjustment July 1, 2012. That is consistent with the wage package that was agreed to by the SEIU bargaining unit earlier this winter. The second major provision is I've agreed to appoint management representatives to a labor management committee that we will create with union representation, and we will look at compensation data by job title within the unit, which is not a reclassification study, which is a whole different ball of wax that the personnel board has undertaken in recent years with non-union positions. This is a wage and compensation study comparing job titles. We would work to identify a list of comparable communities examine wage and other compensation data between the communities and see what conclusions we draw. And that will be just useful information for me to have going forward. And I look forward to having that constructive dialogue and data analysis hand in hand with the union representatives, and we'll see where that leads us. So I was happy to agree to that proposal that they made, and it's something we haven't done in a formal way for that particular set of job titles in a number of years, so I think it's a very timely exercise and will help us in our planning going forward.
Excellent. Congratulations, and thanks to the AFSCME folks for their cooperation with all that. Questions or comments for Mr. Musanti? All right, next.
Next. Lord Jeffrey Inn is reopening. Yes, they're reopening in January 2012. It's been a long process, but an incredibly worthwhile one. I've been asked to participate. I know the select board was invited to an opening ceremony that is occurring this Thursday morning, January 5th at 10 a.m. At the Lord Jeffrey Inn. Very, very excited. The Amherst College, the owners of the inn, have invested upwards of $14-15 million in this renovation. 49 guest rooms have been renovated. They have a function room, ballroom that's been added to the inn. A new restaurant called 30 Boltwood, pub style, upscale pub style, with a focus on local farm to table cuisine is opening in a matter of days. Very excited about that. Right on the edge of Amherst Common, some indoor and outdoor seating related to that. There'll be ability for local groups, business and other groups to have events there, weddings, etc. So we're really excited. I know there are many people in town and in the downtown business community eager to see the Lord Jeff come back to life. And so we're really excited about their reopening. This dovetails with work the town has labored to complete on rehabbing Spring Street itself, including the sidewalk on both sides of the street and the inn. And Amherst College funding a number of the improvements on the sidewalk side on the inside of the street, as well as town investments to improve the Spring Street parking lot. So all that's come together nicely. We're looking forward to the opening and having 2012 be a really momentum building year with the reopening of the Lord Jeffrey Inn, the launch of our Business Improvement District, and the renewed energy focus and money on marketing and event planning and putting on events and other enhanced services in our downtown. So we're really excited about it.
Thank you. That really is such a vital part of the downtown. To have that be back in business will be huge, and to have it be new and improved is very exciting. Ms. Brewer, question?
I'm going to so rudely interrupt the town manager's report to perhaps saying something the chair was going to say later, but because we're talking about the Lord Jeff, to mention that it's also starting to be publicized that the community open house is on Saturday, January 14th. From 1:30 to 4:30, and I'm sure they'll have various personages of great importance there as well. But the big deal one with the ribbon cutting this Thursday is, as they say, by invitation only. Maybe I'll try and sneak in since my other meeting got canceled. But the community is being welcomed by the management Saturday, January 14th, all afternoon. They'll have tours, etc. So people should watch for that.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And next in my report, and Ms. Brewer did mention this earlier in the form of a question, just as for the board's information, I have made appointments to fill the vacancy on the LSSC Commission. John Foster, who's been an active volunteer, coaching and other things in youth activities, a lot of energy and good ideas that we want to put to use on the commission. I've appointed him, and then Sue Cairn, on the Refuse and Recycling and Refuse Management Committee. Again, they have a lot on their agenda in the coming year with looking at the future of our transfer station and all of our recycling initiatives in town. So two important appointments. I wanted the board and the community to be aware of that. Next, briefly, public tree debris removal update. I reported at the December 12th meeting we had engaged through competitive bid local contractor Wagner Wood to assist the town in completing what we called the public portion of the tree debris removal from town right-of-way trees, and that work is ongoing, and we expect to complete that by the end of this week. That's the most current estimate I have from the DPW superintendent. We do have letters that have gone out to property owners that have piles of tree debris that are on their property near the public way that Mr. Snow from DPW has inventoried all of our streets and identified a series of piles that are debris piles from private trees. We've made an offer to property owners to have the town remove that debris using Wagner Wood at a group rate, discounted rate of $28 per cubic yard, which would cover the town's costs to Wagner Wood for the disposal of that. And it's up to the individual property owner whether they want to take advantage of that offer. And I want to encourage property owners who should have received a letter within the last several days from the town to decide whether they want to take advantage of that offer. And if they have questions, please to contact the Department of Public Works and see what can be done. So we're making steady progress there, and we're also looking forward to submittals we will be required to make to the state and federal governments for reimbursement for up to 75% of the disposal costs of the public tree removal portion of the debris. And I hope to be able to report back to the board in the coming months on the status of that.
Thank you. Questions or comments about tree removal? Tree debris removal, not removal of trees, sorry.
Okay. Next, briefly, I know there was some notice in the newspaper recently. The Hitchcock Center and Hampshire College made a major announcement that they have entered into a memorandum of understanding non-binding that could result in a new state-of-the-art environmental learning center to be owned and operated by Hitchcock Center on the grounds of Hampshire College, and there'll be some exploratory work in the next few months between those two parties to see what specifics can be agreed upon, and that would be the basis then to negotiate a long-term ground lease between Hitchcock Center and Hampshire College. We've had a long-standing relationship with the Hitchcock Center and Julie Johnson, the executive director, because they've been renting space at Larch Hill Conservation Area for many years. And we've been in the loop on this right along. We're entirely supportive of giving them an opportunity to grow and also stay within the town of Amherst. And we applaud that partnership with Hampshire College and helping Hampshire College fulfill its mission to be a leader in environmental education as well. So wanted to highlight that. Next, I wanted to mention University Health Services. You know that in recent weeks, the university announced some cutbacks from their expanded hours of service that they were offering, that the chancellor has named a new special committee to review those proposed changes. They'll be looking to identify cost savings and developing a financial plan for their goal of building a new health services facility on campus sometime within the next 5 years or so. And the campus has reached out to the town through Nancy Buffone. I've been in touch with Nancy Buffone, and there will be opportunities for myself and town staff, fire chief, health director, et cetera, to offer input to this committee, and Nancy will help make that happen. So I wanted the board to be aware of that effort. And that's what I have for now.
Questions or comments from Mr. Musanti on any of these issues or anything else? Ms. Brewer.
I appreciate that relationship with Nancy Buffone, who also happens to be my next door neighbor, but yes. Her relationship with the town and the fact that UMass, as we've talked about on several occasions, has really stepped up in the last couple of years and really giving us someone direct to talk to that we know, you know, that is known by our fire chief, our police chief knows her, et cetera, and so they can have those conversations because, as one might imagine, since I work part-time on campus, although I don't work for UMass, there's been a lot of upset associated with this discussion, and so it's nice to know that we have a place to share our concerns as well. So thank you for that relationship.
All right, member reports, liaison representative reports. Anyone?
Sure.
Ms. Stein.
See, the Agricultural Commission canceled their meeting last month. The Board of Health met, and they are still working on the outdoor wood boilers from many different perspectives, what kind of fuel, how they should be licensed, recommended practices, public health issues, and so on. And they're also working on the Emergency Preparedness Coalition, which would be for Eastern Hampshire County. And I hope to report in more detail on that next time. Okay. We also, there's a Hampshire Regional Emergency Committee that has been doing practice exercises and such long before the Halloween storm and the hurricane. And they got some grant money, which has been divided up amongst the participating communities for supplies that will help prepare for future emergencies. So I thought I should announce that. The Community Preservation Act Committee met in December and discussed briefly the proposals they had received. I think it was very clear that their new proposal letter, where they gave much more guidance as to how proposers should submit their proposal, gave very satisfactory results. They saw a big improvement in the way the proposals came through. And so that was good news, and that they are interested in trying to make sure that when the public hearing is held on February 16th, they will have sufficiently good publicity, because some years we get a lot of people coming to the public hearing to voice their opinions on what should be funded with CPAC funds, and some years nobody shows up, so they're going to work on that. So that seems all that I need to say about CPAC. I thought Aaron was going to talk about this, but since he's not here, I will. TMCC has put together a meeting for January 31st, which will be at 7 p.m. in the Jones Library, the Amherst Room. And it is a meeting to interest new members of town meeting. People who have any interest in joining town meeting, are curious about it, would like to talk, hear a presentation, talk to four or five different members representing different points of view who serve or have served on town meeting, this is the opportunity to do so. And I encourage people who have any interest in running for town meeting to join this group and or go to this meeting and find out about it, because it's an excellent opportunity. And we are a participatory democracy, so this is your chance to participate. And I think that's all that I was going to say. So
I'll just mention, related to that, that every town meeting seat is up for re-election this year because of the redistricting that was required by the 2010 federal census. So every one of the 240 town meeting seats is up. Anyone who is interested in running for town meeting, it only requires one signature, and that can be your own. The forms are available at the town clerk's office, and they must be returned by February 14th, Valentine's Day. Ms. Brewer.
I appreciate you mentioning that, because for whatever reason, and I'm sure it's my phone's fault, not the town website's, but the town website under the elections calendar doesn't say a word about the 2012 election yet in comparison to the 2011, the 2010, et cetera. So it's probably just a little glitch there. So thank you for reminding us that that's coming up, because we see that in our on our table tonight. We also had the information about town meeting schedule, which I'm sure we'll be talking about more, but it's good to remember all these things coming together in the spring with the February 14th date. The other thing I was sure Ms. Stein was going to mention was the planning board discussion being held tomorrow night.
Zoning forum.
At 5 o'clock.
But that's Aaron, too, you see.
Yeah, that's true. But I know how excited that's you are about zoning priorities.
But I have it in my calendar, so you're correct. Go ahead. Right, 5 to 6:30.
Yeah, we don't have that posted, and I'm not planning to attend or anything. And we wouldn't be deliberating anyway, even if all of us showed up. So
this is when they lay out, they listen to comments from people in town about what zoning issues people should be working on. And give input on such things as Article 17 last time, how they would like that changed.
Right, and so that folks know, there's also going to be a roundtable discussion specifically about the North Amherst and South Amherst rezoning at the following zoning subcommittee meeting, which is 2 weeks from tomorrow. So that is the 18th, January 18th, is going to be specifically about North and South Amherst rezoning. So they want to get all of the feedback from folks from how Article 17 was proposed the first time and how it should go forward in the future. And the zoning forum, which is tomorrow night, January 4th at 5 o'clock, they do this after every town meeting. This has been a twice yearly occurrence, where, as Ms. Stein said, they solicit all the input from the public about what sorts of zoning priorities there should be going forward. It will not concentrate solely on the North and South Amherst rezoning because that will be a specific meeting on the 18th. But folks are encouraged to attend both of those meetings because that's a very important way that the zoning subcommittee and the planning board determine the priorities for what the community wants brought forward for the future. Okay, anything else on those items? Ms. Brewer, do you have any liaison reports?
Quickly, CDBG Advisory Committee met last week, or I should say not last week, it's the week before that, and right before the holidays. And they, as we had discussed before, are looking at what information they're going to ask of the various applicants so that they know, so that they have a better sense moving forward the next time someone applies for something, exactly how the money was used. So it's one thing to apply for the money and think you'll have a program that does X, Y, and Z, but occasionally things go off schedule, and so they want to make sure they're able to follow that throughout the process. So that's coming along nicely. They really appreciate having 6 members, just as I'm sure Leisure Services will very much appreciate having 7 members. They haven't had 7 members in 3 years, to the best of my knowledge, so it really increases their ability to go ahead and have a meeting when quorum is 4. So that will be really great. The only other thing I wanted to mention at this time, and I obviously need to put a lot more work into this effort of outreach myself, is the Housing and Sheltering Committee has almost no applicants associated with it right now. Obviously, the holidays were a difficult time to be doing that. We were kind of at the end of town meeting, holidays, et cetera, but that's something we're going to start mentioning a lot more. And the other thing I should mention is the Regional School District Planning Committee, which is having a meeting, our second meeting this week at 4:30, followed by a meeting at 5, which is going to be with representatives from the other towns in our region, Leverett, Pelham, and Shutesbury committees, so that we can talk about a grant application opportunity that came up just like that. And I mentioned earlier tonight my frustration with words in the English language that don't seem to mean what they say they mean on paper. When I looked at the grant application, I said, please, we're nowhere near ready to apply for this. Amherst can't, you know, do this. We don't have these figures. We don't know this. We don't know that, even though we've put a lot of effort into this in the past. And we were assured that it was kind of a hurry-up situation, unlike, say, the park grant. And we were supposed to actually, you know, apply in the middle of January and find out in February whether or not we got the money. And apparently they need plenty of applicants for this particular pool of money. So, you know, it all comes down to who else applies and who else think is dissuaded by the language. So who knows? At this point, it is just, it it's not supposed to be planning feasibility money. It's supposed to be planning, but not feasibility. It's very confusing. But some other people agreed to work on it from the other town. Shutesbury in particular was taking the lead, Catherine Oppie from the town of Amherst. And so they were trying to work on that over the holidays so that we'd have something to submit. So if you hear something about that, don't worry. It doesn't mean that we've committed to doing anything. We're just looking for some resources, because one of the things we found when I was one of the three people that worked on the last iteration of this group is that nobody had time to develop all these figures. You know, we'd say to Rob Detweiler, who we see, you know, coming before us with budget things, so how about you spend another, you know, couple of weeks developing this set of information for us? Well, when was he going to do that? And the same for the superintendent, et cetera. So in hopes that we can find somebody to develop some of that information for us, because it seems like it should be easy to find, but not necessarily so. So again, those meetings are coming up, and we're originally hoping to have the first of the set of many public forums that's associated with the town meeting article in the middle of January, but I suspect that when we talk about it later this week, we'll say, wow, that's coming up really soon, and there's a lot of other stuff going on too. But we'd like to get going, because some of the other towns seem to be a little further ahead of us in terms of the process, because they've been talking about this for the past year, whereas we've been kind of on hold for the past year. So I'll keep you posted on what's happening there. Right now, it's meetings and a possible grant.
Great. Thank you. All right. Anything else? My only liaison report is Campus and Community Coalition met right before Christmas. And the thing that they were talking about, the folks they were reporting on, was that UMass Night Out, that thing that they did on December 2nd, where they had all kinds of activities going on late into the night, maybe all night long, December 2nd into December 3rd. That was very successful. They had, they believe, 12 to 1,500 students participate in the various activities. It was mainly coordinated by the student affairs folks, but it obviously involved participation from a lot of different departments who helped to make it happen. So those folks are now looking at it, kind of seeing, you know, how did they do? How, what would they do differently for the future? And they're very excited about it and hope to make it monthly for the spring semester. So they hope to do it February, March, and April, one night in each of those times. So so that is exciting, and it's something that, again, that was directly in response to a lot of town and public safety feedback to them, saying, you know what students are telling, in particular our public safety folks, is that kind of these marauding bands of parties that, like, just, you know, groups of kids, huge groups of kids moving down the street looking for something to do, is because there isn't anything going on campus. They really don't have any alternatives. So the university has really embraced this, and they're trying to make some fun alternatives. So we'll see how that goes. Additionally, the coalition has been doing a lot of work on trying to figure out what its priorities are going forward, and in particular, what the kind of the strengths and weaknesses of the organization are. One of the things that we've identified is that we need a way to include landlords and property management organizations more in the discussions. We do have a municipal strategy subcommittee that does include a landlord, president of the local landlord association, but we need to be having a much greater dialogue with them so that they understand what the issues are and kind of what everyone's needs are. It was really great to have Public Health Director Julie Fetterman talking with David Valancourt, who is the new, I can't remember how all their titles work over there. He's the new vice chancellor or something like that for off-campus and graduate housing. He's somebody who's been with Residence Life for like 20 years or something, but now he is heading up an off-campus resource center. So that's really going to be a place that they're funneling information through for off-campus mm-hmm. stuff. So really great discussions between those two, and great potential for how kind of the town and the university look at these issues going forward. Continues to be a very good group. That's my only liaison report.
Can I ask a question?
Yes.
Actually, I have a question regarding a liaison report and a question for the town manager that I forgot to ask.
Right ahead.
Did you say the CPAC hearing was February
16th.
16th. Thank you. Because I know that comes up at some of the committees I go to. Thank you. And I'm sure it's on the town website. And my question for the town manager, I'm sorry if I blanked out on this somehow. I know we're really excited about the building commissioner position. Have we actually hired the code enforcement inspector? Because I know how originally what we'd intended to do, but where are we with that now?
We've completed the interview process. We're in the midst of a discussion with our leading candidate.
Okay, good. It's exciting to think that all this is coming together, so great. Thank you.
Okay, open meeting law update.
Another thing, which it was so great. I said to the office, we should put something about this in the packet, but I don't have time to look it up, and they just looked it up, and here it is. So the piece in the packet is talking about knowing or knowingly violating open meeting law, which you can imagine the kinds of comments that kind of go around in cyberspace associated with this concept. I understand what the Attorney General is trying to do here, and I appreciate that they're asking us for comments, although, again, they never give us much time to do that. They want us to have this done by the time we basically leave for the MMA meeting on Thursday the 19th. I don't have anything prepared, so if anybody has any, you know, thoughts about this particular thing, we're going to have to send them in individually. I am planning to send something in saying that, you know, as an individual member of a body, this is what I think. My two concerns, right, being in reading this a couple of different times and looking at it in different websites, is it talks about whether or not a violation, they're looking at, this is like kind of inside baseball for people who really don't care about this stuff, for those of us who have to deal with it all the time. It talks about whether or not the public body or the public body member has been informed previously by receipt of a decision from a court of competent jurisdiction or advised by the Attorney General that such conduct violates the law. So that seems pretty clear from the standpoint that, okay, the Attorney General told you in January, don't do this again, and then you do it in June, well, then you're gonna get a fine for doing it again. Okay, that's clear. You go to court over it, and you find out in February that you lost the decision, well, then you better not do it again 2 years later because your town's kind of already on the map for having done it. What I'm not clear on, and I doubt that they are either, is what informed and by receipt means. Because we get memos from, say, Kopelman and Page that say, there was some random court case. Here you go. Well, sometimes we get those memos, and sometimes we don't get them until we show up at MMA. And, like, do we know if they really apply to us or not? And, you know, what counts as being told? I mean, I can totally get that if your community was told, then you would know that. But because they're putting all this other stuff up on the website, which I think is fantabulous, I'm a little concerned about what they mean by informed. I'm also concerned about what's sufficient, because in terms of if this goes far enough from another standpoint, which is the example that I will provide to them, which is not as unusual as I'd like it to be, which is that if one knows of a committee that's planning to call an executive session, for example, for a particular reason, and you, as a person who is so fascinated by this topic, is convinced, just as another volunteer, that that's not a good idea, that that would not meet the legal requirement, but the other person says, yes, it does. You know, how much blame does the person take at that point, whether or not they do it? Given that we supposedly go through this training, we supposedly read the stuff, if some of the people at the table say, I'm pretty sure that's not a good idea, and other people go ahead and do it anyway, well, whose fault is that then? I mean, we're all volunteers. We don't want to make people's lives unnecessarily cumbersome, but we want people to feel like they have some responsibility to find out. Like, go ahead and ask. You know, get an okay from somebody. So I'm just planning basically to ask the office, you know, when I write my little note, because I've decided one of my New Year's resolutions is to write something kind of small and not too beautifully worded just to get it written, is, you know, what is their thinking behind that as to what happens when you have difficulties within a community, for example, because we see that all the time in newspapers. You know, the planning board in some other town thinks the select board's doing crazy stuff, and they want to complain about it, but they're not attorneys, and they're not the Attorney General's office. So, you know, at what point does a volunteer need to listen to whoever? okay. before somebody can get
So you're going to submit those comments?
I'll submit, something Great. Along those lines.
And so if we have particular thoughts on it, we should submit individually yes. also. Ms. Stein, did you have your hand raised about that?
No, I think Alyssa's covered it. I was just going to help with the discussion as I understood it, but I think she's really put her finger on the important issue. What is informed? You know, a blanket statement shot into the world may not reach the people who need to hear it. And I'm sure there are times when people act against the open meeting law out of ignorance. They just simply aren't aware that, you know, that crosses the line.
Okay. All right. Next up, chair's report. The only thing in the chair's report is I just wanted to review the fact that town meeting is coming up. Feels like it's just ended, and it has, but it's coming up again. It begins April 30th. That's just a couple days early this year. Usually it starts in May. So it begins April 30th. That means we have deadlines coming up for articles. The citizens zoning petition deadline is February 6th. So that's about a month from right now. There is a month difference between the citizens zoning petition articles and then citizens other kinds of articles and all other articles. So that other deadline, non-zoning, non-citizen zoning article deadline is March 5th. And those dates will all be upon us before we know it. We already talked a little bit about the election. The annual town election is Tuesday, April 3rd. That, of course, will be upon us very quickly also. And so there's just a lot going on in the next couple of months, which is a good segue to the calendar preview. January, we only meet, I'm putting meet in quotes, one other time in January, and that's the 23rd, but actually we meet a whole bunch of times before then. Our next regular select board meeting is the 23rd of January, but we will be meeting, as a reminder to folks, in about a week and a half on Friday the 13th. Dun, dun, dun. That is the 4 o'clock meeting, joint meeting with the Finance Committee here in this room for the town manager's budget presentation. We are also meeting this coming Saturday, the 7th, for as many of us as who can show up. The meeting is posted. This is the four towns meeting when we get together with select boards, finance committees, school committees from the other towns in the region and talk about what the regional budget situation and circumstances looks like going forward. That is this Saturday, the 7th. We also have coming up the annual Martin Luther King Community Breakfast. That is not a meeting, but is something many select board members attend, and the MMA annual meeting and conference, as we've already discussed. All three of us who are here tonight will be attending that, as well as Mr. Musanti. So it is a busy month, even though we have only one regular, quote, regular select board meeting during it. So this is the beginning of what 2012 is looking like. Any questions or comments about any of the upcoming scheduling issues? Okay, then let's try and finish up any untimed items and get out of here.
Minutes.
Minutes is the big thing. Is that the only thing? Yes, we already did the appointments. Yes, okay. I looked through all the minutes and I was fine with all of them.
Pardon?
I looked through the minutes and I was fine with all of them.
I have very few corrections, but I do. What's that?
I wanted to see if you caught that one. It's a simple typo. It's like so irrelevant.
No, I didn't. I caught where you were left off, even though you attended, though.
Are you sure?
I'm pretty sure. But we were only. I have my little points. I mean, we're missing certain things like submitted by and list of documents
okay.
off a number of them.
Okay.
But they're not things that we need to discuss. There are just two things I did want to ask about. This is September 12th, and this is more a question of follow-up than anything that has to be changed, okay? It says at the end that a working proposal based on previous discussions and Ms. Stein's recommendations of 72911 was drafted with the goal to assist town staff not to fill an oversight role. The board coalesced around the idea of a body that meets formally a couple of times a year, but is mostly available to management as a group or individuals if and as needed. The point is that I don't think we followed up on that.
Right, we haven't done that yet.
Yeah.
So that's
something for us to follow up on. So I will just cross that out. And then Also, on that same set of minutes, there was talk of drafting a letter to the committees and boards, et cetera, that don't have liaisons. Have we ever done that? You were going to sign it.
I think Aaron did draft it, and I don't think that it did go out. But but I noticed that in the minutes also,
yeah,
so I need to follow up on
those
that.
Those, to me, were just points to follow up on. And that's it. The rest are, you know, typo-type things, like missing the documents. And,
okay. If those are
minutes that ended abruptly, nobody signed off on them.
Okay. So if those are all just technical corrections that are clear, they'll be clear for
Mr. Sal. I think it's very clear.
Okay,
but if not, people can write to me and say,
under this one too. With
oh, here's line. Another one.
It's just a typo.
It's just a typo. And that's all mine are, and very few of them.
Also, I just said, here you go.
Yeah, the ones in orange are Alyssa's. The ones in black ink are mine.
Okay, so Ms. Roussel will be in touch. So we need to vote on approving them as amended.
Yeah,
Ms. Brewer.
And
exactly.
I think we can kind of do that as a lump, which is great. But I would also mention, as the town manager's making a note there, it should say select board present and select board absent. It needs to show present and absent. That's clear in the new open meeting law.
Yeah.
Didn't used to be, but.
Very good.
So
all right.
I can make a motion. I move that the select board approve the minutes of July 25th, 2011, August 29th, 2011, September 12th, 2011, October 3rd, 2011, October 18th, 2011, October 24th, 2011, and November 7th, 2011, as amended.
Second.
Further discussion. All in favor say aye.
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 Aye. 3-0. 2 absent. Thank you very much. Anything else we need to talk about before we adjourn? Mr. Musanti.
I did have one excruciatingly brief comment to make that I meant to make at the end of my town manager's report, and that's about me. I'm back at work officially full time.
Wow. Yay.
And, with very stern advice from my medical team to pay attention to what my body tells me, but I wanted the board officially to know that and the community to know that, and it's a good feeling.
It's good to have you back.
Hallelujah. Absolutely. Okay, then, if there is no objection, the next time we shall all see each other, many of us will see each other on Saturday at the four boards meeting, and then the next official select board meeting that we're all expected to be here for is the 13th for the budget presentation, 4 o'clock in this room. And then without objection, this meeting adjourns at 8:35.